Tonight on NewsWatch, taking out Gaddafi. At least one U.S. lawmaker says we should target the Libyan dictator. Plus, bloodshed in Syria. Police fire at thousands of their own countrymen. What's next for the embattled government? And bionic food. Some items at the grocery store are as much a product of a laboratory as a farm. But is that a good thing? All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. NATO airstrikes are again targeting Muammar Gaddafi's sprawling compound in Tripoli. Good evening, everyone. I'm Lee Webb. This comes after his forces unleashed a barrage of shells and rockets at Misrata this weekend. Three members of the U.S. Senate Armed Services Committee now say more must be done to drive out the Libyan dictator. Ephraim Graham has more in tonight's top story.
This is the aftermath of the NATO airstrikes that hit the center of Muammar Gaddafi's seat of power this morning. The strikes destroyed a library and office and damaged a reception hall for visiting dignitaries. A security official says four people were lightly hurt, but Gaddafi's whereabouts are still not known.
But I really fear a stalemate. I hope that Gaddafi goes. I hope that there's that kind of overthrow from within, but hope is not a strategy.
Senator John McCain made a surprise visit to the country this weekend. He and others are calling on NATO to do more.
The point is that we can't count on taking Gaddafi out. What we can count on is a trained, equipped, well-supported liberation forces which can either force Gaddafi out or obtain victory and send him to an international criminal court. My emphasis is on winning the battle on the ground, not taking a chance on taking him out with a lucky airstrike.
Just last week, President Obama authorized the use of American Predator drones in the fight. Some congressional leaders say that's a step in the right direction, but it's not enough.
You know, you can't get into a fight with one foot. You got to get into it. And therefore, I think the use of our Predator drones, which have extraordinary capabilities, was the right thing to do. And I thank President Obama's commander-in-chief for authorizing that to happen.
I think the focus should now be to cut the head of the snake off. That's the quickest way to end this.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
An eyewitness says members of the Syrian army shot and killed 11 people in the city of Daraa today. It is the latest bloody crackdown on protesters trying to force President Bashar Assad from office. The witness claims the army fired indiscriminately on civilians. Saturday, Syrian forces fired on funeral processions for protesters killed the previous day. Several people were reportedly killed Saturday, and at least 300 people have died since the protest began. The White House says it is considering sanctions against Assad's government. Joining us is senior international correspondent Gary Lane. Gary has traveled to Syria several times over the years and has reported extensively from the Middle East. Gary, how likely is it that Assad will be forced from office?
I would say, Lee, not likely in the short term, maybe in the long term, as the people of Syria turn against him. The people in the Middle East don't have much of a stomach for their leaders turning against their own people. They can fight the Israelis, they can denounce the Israelis, fight other Muslims. Mm-hmm. But when they turn against their own people, that's it with the people. So until that happens, but we're seeing more people coming out.
Gary, how different is this uprising in Syria compared to the one, say, in Egypt and the one in Libya?
Well, I think you have to look at the army as well. In Egypt, the army, the military, was very restrained in firing on the people. Here in Syria, they're not holding back. They're doing it. They're going after the people, and they're bringing in tanks now. I don't know if you saw that today, but tanks have been, over the weekend, were reported in a number of cities and actually being used against the people and firing on funeral processions as people are mourning, Lee. The people aren't going to put up with that much longer. Now, the key is, will they have a militia like we've seen in Libya and elsewhere going against the government? Do they have the arms and the will to do it?
If Assad is forced from office, will that be a good thing?
Well, it may be a good thing. One thing to keep in mind here is he's from a minority party, or a minority group, the Alawites. They're only about 12-13% of the population there.
Shiites, the majority?
No, it's about 75% Sunni.
Sunni, okay.
So it depends on who comes into power. Now, we don't know. There's an old saying, the devil you have is better than the one that you may have. But we'll have to wait and see who comes into power. Right now, there's nobody that would take over. But it's likely it would be a Sunni. And they're about 75% of the population there. If you have a Sunni, what that would mean is a distancing from Iran, distancing from Hezbollah, that may be a good thing.
That would be a good thing for Israel,
That'd
right?
That'd be good for Israel and the United States. Mm-hmm. But we don't know certain at this point who is going to take over. Will it be a militant Sunni Muslim?
Why is it the U.S. talking about military action in Syria if we're doing it in Libya?
Well, because I think we're stretched right now. We've got 2.5 wars going right now. I don't know if our military, do you, can handle that. Also, if we, if the American people have the will to intervene everywhere that there's an unrest or a disruption in a country.
Well, thanks for bringing us up to date. Keep an eye
out
for us. All right. Thank you, Gary. And more violence in Yemen today as government troops there attack protesters. Dale Hurd has that story.
This amateur video from the southern city of Taiz shows forces loyal to Yemen's embattled president attacking protesters who were calling for his ouster. Soldiers fired bullets and tear gas and used water cannon. A leading Yemeni activist says dozens had gunshot wounds. In 3 protests nationwide, 2 were reported killed. Since Yemen's unrest erupted over 2 months ago, more than 130 people have been killed by security forces and government supporters. The protesters want President Abdullah Ali Saleh to leave. Saleh has ruled for 32 years. In San Francisco Sunday, hundreds rallied at UN Plaza to show their solidarity with the protesters.
People in Yemen are being killed for nothing more than standing up and speaking out against injustice. They have been protesting peacefully. We demand the United States government end all military aid to Yemen.
On Saturday, Saleh reportedly agreed to an Arab proposal to leave within 30 days of signing a deal and transferring power to a deputy. But that agreement is now reportedly off. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Taliban militants broke at least 480 inmates out of the main prison in Kandahar, Afghanistan overnight. A Taliban spokesman says about 100 of the escapees are Taliban commanders. Many of the others are soldiers. They got out through a 1,000-foot tunnel. It took months to dig that tunnel. A man who claims to have organized the escape says friends gave him keys to the cells. Prisoners were taken out 4 at a time over a 5-hour period. Authorities say they did not notice the escape until all the prisoners were gone. The Taliban has a strong presence in Kandahar. WikiLeaks released another batch of classified documents today. This time it was close to 800 secret military files about al-Qaeda and terrorist detainees at the Guantanamo Bay prison in Cuba. U.S. and European newspapers are sifting through the revealing information. It provides insights into some of the prison's most notorious detainees, like Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, the alleged mastermind of the 9/11 attacks. The records contain details of more than 700 detainee interrogations, along with evidence that the U.S. collected. The government has already transferred 604 detainees out of Gitmo. 72 still remain at the facility. U.S. Attorney General Eric Holder said today that protecting Americans from homegrown extremist groups is one of his priorities. He made the comments in a speech to Justice Department employees. He told them they've made America safer. Holder also warned that the job is not done, though. He says his current priorities include protecting Americans from violent crimes and financial fraud. He especially wants to protect children, the elderly, and victims of hate crimes and human trafficking. A bomb exploded outside a Baghdad church Easter Sunday, wounding 4 policemen and 3 others. Shrapnel damaged the Sacred Heart Church building, but no one was inside at the time. About 700 Christians attended Easter services at the Chaldean church in Baghdad. The Reverend Franklin Graham says the conflicts in the Middle East and other global crises are signs of the end times. He talked about it with Christian Amanpour on ABC's This Week.
I believe we are in the latter days of this age. When I say latter days, could it be the last 100 years or the last 1,000 years or the last 6 months? I don't know. But the Bible, the things that the Bible predicts, earthquakes and famines, nation rising against nation, we see this happening with more frequency and more intensity.
Reverend Graham also weighed in on the 2012 presidential race, saying he could support Donald Trump for president.
Donald Trump, when I first saw that he was getting in, I thought, well, this has got to be a joke. But the more you listen to him, the more you say to yourself, you know, maybe the guy's right.
He might be your candidate of choice.
Sure, yeah, sure.
Trump's pro-life stance has been winning him favor with evangelical leaders. He first made those comments in an exclusive interview with CBN's David Brody. Christians from around the world packed Jerusalem's Garden Tomb Sunday for its annual Easter sunrise service. They came to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ in the place many people believe was the site of his resurrection. Many told CBN News it was a profound experience.
It's brought me right back to the very day when Jesus was risen.
It means a lot to me to be here where Jesus was buried, and then I know he's not there anymore.
It's definitely the highlight of my trip to Israel, and just to celebrate Easter Sunday in the city where everything happened. Is
because Christ is risen, you know, life has sense. You know, it has a reason for us to want to tell others about what's going on and why Jesus is our Savior.
He is risen indeed. And if you would like to watch Sunday's Easter sunrise service from the Garden Tomb, you can log on to cbnnews.com. Coming up, gas prices soar and thieves come up with creative ways to get free fuel.
Do you take fish oil? There's an omega-3 supplement that's better than regular fish oil.
Staying healthy, it's not easy. I exercise regularly and eat lots of fruits and vegetables. I used to take a fish oil supplement too, but then I discovered something better than regular fish oil.
Arctic Wonder Omega-3 Krill Oil. It's from the makers of One-A-Day, so I know I can trust it. The omega-3s in Arctic Wonder both support heart health and are scientifically proven to be better absorbed than regular fish oil. You'd have to take 6 of these fish oil soft gels to get the strength of just 2 Arctic Wonder soft gels.
The Arctic Wonder does not have an aftertaste.
They go down real easy.
Arctic Wonder isn't just good for your heart. It also supports healthy brain function and a healthy immune system.
This is one of the products that I plan to take for the rest of my life.
Arctic Wonder is from One-A-Day and not available in stores. For a special trial offer, call or go online now. Call 1-800-409-7339. That's 1-800-409-7339. Or go online to tryarcticwonder.com now. Do you take fish oil? There's an omega-3 supplement that's better than regular fish oil.
Staying healthy, it's not easy. I exercise regularly and eat lots of fruits and vegetables. I used to take a fish oil supplement too, but then I discovered something better than regular fish oil.
Arctic Wonder Omega-3 Krill Oil. It's from the makers of One-A-Day, so I know I can trust it. The omega-3s in Arctic Wonder both support heart health and are scientifically proven to be better absorbed than regular fish oil. You'd have to take 6 of these fish oil soft gels to get the strength of just 2 Arctic Wonder soft gels.
The Arctic Wonder does not have an aftertaste.
They go down real easy.
Arctic Wonder isn't just good for your heart. It also supports healthy brain function and a healthy immune system.
This is one of the products that I plan to take for the rest of my life.
Arctic Wonder is from One-A-Day and not available in stores. For a special trial offer, call or go online now. Call 1-800-409-7339. That's 1-800-409-7339. Or go online to tryarcticwonder.com now.
The U.S. Supreme Court will not place Virginia's case against President Obama's health care reform law on the fast track. The justices today rejected the request by Virginia Attorney General Ken Cuccinelli to resolve questions about the law's constitutionality. The Obama administration argued the case should work its way through the appeals process before reaching the nation's top court. It is rare for the Supreme Court to step into a legal fight before the appeals court process. Today, Cuccinelli said he was disappointed by the move, but not surprised. It could still reach the Supreme Court by the summer of next year. Police say a suspect accused of trying to bomb a Colorado mall last week had just been released from prison. Investigators believe Earl Albert Moore rigged propane tanks and a pipe bomb to explode. They didn't go off. It was at a mall just a mile from Columbine High School, and it happened on the anniversary of the 1999 massacre at that school. Moore has an extensive criminal record. Federal authorities released him from prison just 7 days before the attempted bombing. He's still on the loose. As gas prices climb, gas thieves are on the hunt. They're not just driving off without paying for gas. They're targeting individual cars and even businesses. Charlene Israel explains.
Drivers everywhere are fed up with high gas prices.
Over $110 a week, easy.
Higher prices have given way to an increased number of gas thieves.
You're seeing customers just fed up with seeing price increases day after day after day. They don't know who to take it out on, so they take it out on the guy who sells them gas.
Most gas thefts occur when a driver fills up at the pump and then speeds away without paying. Some gas thieves siphon gas. That's when a hose is fed into your car's gas tank and the gas is sucked right out of your car.
This is a 5/16 inch fuel line. That's going right in here.
Gas thieves are even posting how-to videos on YouTube. Businesses are also being targeted. In Hickory, North Carolina, thieves stole thousands of dollars of gas from a company's rental trucks. They crawled under the trucks and cut the fuel lines to drain the gasoline.
Kind of hurts when you get reservations for trucks and you haven't got the trucks to send out.
In 2009, drivers who sped off without paying for gas accounted for more than $89 million. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
A record number of people took part in a White House tradition today, the annual Easter egg roll. 30,000 children and parents from every state in the union took part in the event. The first family greeted the crowd and took turns reading books. Sasha and Malia read Where the Wild Things Are. President and Mrs. Obama read Chicka Chicka Boom Boom.
We are so excited about this year's Easter egg roll. The theme is Get Up and Go, because as you know, I'm a big proponent of getting up and going, making sure we're moving and eating healthy. And this Easter egg roll reflects all of that. So while you're here, in addition to listening to some great music and dancing a little bit, you can roll your eggs, you can do some yoga, you can play with some, do some obstacle courses, play basketball and tennis.
All right, the Easter egg roll tradition began in 1878. Up next, using science to grow crops faster and better. But are they safe?
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was gonna be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were gonna die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they saved my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Almost every grain product grown in the U.S. is referred to as GMO foods or genetically modified foods. Six European nations have banned them. Should America do the same? Lori Johnson examines that question in tonight's Focus Report.
You could call them bionic foods because they're touted as bigger, stronger, and faster. The scientific name is GMO, genetically modified organisms. They're a new generation of super crops created by splicing characteristics from one species into the DNA of another.
GMOs are at the cutting edge of making food safer, more affordable, more abundant, and giving people more choices.
They're engineered to produce higher yields, contain more vitamins and minerals, while resisting insects and plant diseases. Some GMOs even grow in droughts, floods, and extreme temperatures where they couldn't before. Billionaire Bill Gates is investing in these crops to ease starvation in developing countries.
We need to take full advantage of these emerging technologies to develop new crop varieties. And we need to make these seeds available to the small farmers who need them.
In America, a whopping 85% of corn, soybeans, sugar beets, and canola are grown from GMO seed. So far, the FDA has only approved this technology for plants, but they may soon give the go-ahead to the first genetically modified animal, farm-raised salmon. And get this, it grows to market size up to 4 times faster than other farm-raised salmon. Genetically modified foods have been in our food supply for 15 years, and most of us eat them every day. But critics of GMOs say it's time to reverse this trend. In his book, Seeds of Deception, author Jeffrey Smith highlights research that this food can cause increased allergic reactions, resistance to antibiotics, reproductive problems, accelerated aging, and immune system damage.
Unfortunately, the biotech industry has basically been marching lockstep with the government and vice versa for the past 20 years. And they refuse to look at the increasing evidence that GMOs are unsafe, both for the health and the environment.
But those studies are refuted by other research, according to Sharon Bowman-Lauritsen, who represents several biotechnology companies.
The studies that actually have shown that biotechnology is completely safe have been done by preeminent scientists around the world. The U.S. National Academy of Sciences, the American Medical Association, all three U.S. government agencies that regulate these products have all reviewed the scientific facts related to these products, and they are completely safe.
Joel Salatin is a successful organic farmer featured in the movie Food, Inc. He rejects GMOs, saying they're not part of God's plan.
And so that fundamentally violates the very pattern and order that God ordained in Genesis for creation and its sustainability.
Other critics are worried about the disruption of the natural food chain, loss of biological diversity, and cross-pollination.
You've got a field of genetically engineered alfalfa, and the bees from that field move over to your non-genetically modified field or your organic field and contaminate it.
The Food and Drug Administration does not require food manufacturers to disclose whether they use genetically modified ingredients in their products. We wanted to talk to them about that, but they declined our request for an interview and instead referred us to their website,
which says the law prohibits food labeling that's misleading, and the FDA has not found that foods from genetically engineered organisms present greater safety concerns than their conventional counterparts. So if it's not on the label, how do you know if you're buying a GMO food? Simply, most processed foods contain them. Those are the packaged foods you find in the middle of the grocery store. Typically, the raw fruits and vegetables on the perimeter of the store are GMO-free, as are organic foods. Some food manufacturers make it easy and label their foods GMO-free. So the debate continues. Some say GMOs are the best hope for the world's food shortage, while others say they're our worst nightmare. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
You can get more information on both sides of this debate by going to cbnnews.com. Up next, reaching the lost on a bar stool, how one pastor is using an unconventional approach to spread God's word.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes, we'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
You probably heard the saying, the church is about the body, not the building. Well, one Connecticut church put that to the test yesterday. Frontline City Church of New Haven held its Easter services in a somewhat unconventional location, a bar. Pastor Justin Kendrick used Easter as a platform to launch the new church. He knows it's out of the ordinary, but he says that's the point.
The Bible never talks about what the building should look like, so we're open to meet everywhere and anywhere for God's glory.
It breaks down a lot of barriers and stigmas that people are used to at church. There's a lot of judgment and not grace associated with church. This just is a place that's welcome to everybody. It's places that, you know, people may have come last night and then they're going to come in the morning, in the door this morning.
The pastor says that even though meeting at a bar is a new approach, he hopes it brings about the traditional spirit of community. That's all for this edition of NewsWatch. Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. And we hope you'll join us next time. Good night.